undergone massive challenge in the past few years, all driven by the internet and what happens when you digitise content. So newspapers have seen their kind of whole market just disappear. The whole business models have been corrupted by the loss of ads and things, and the fact that anyone becomes a journalist via blogs and things. The music industry was kind of fabulously inept at understanding what was happening with the digitisation of content. And so record shops and record companies, that the whole reason for their existence has almost disappeared overnight. So you have groups like Radiohead and things kind of bypassing them and releasing straight to the audience. And broadcast is kind of being challenged by things like YouTube and just the amount of time that people spend online and interactive. And I'm kind of joking here, but there is a kind of a serious point. Is learning or education somehow intrinsically different from doing things like Facebook or sharing photos on Flickr? You know, is learning intrinsically just a bit dull? You know, it's rewarding work and stuff, but it's a bit dull. It's a bit hard work. You know. Okay, next slide. If you think about the characteristics of what we might call Web 2.0, so at the top we've got this, it's very technology oriented, it's very kind of driven by user generated content, things like Wikipedia and stuff, and when learning does take place, it's kind of very informal, you kind of bump into resources or people kind of through connections. And down at the bottom right, you've got the idea from Tim O'Reilly that the web is a platform now. You don't need applications and things. You can do everything through the web. This idea of harnessing collective intelligence, so you kind of get everyone to contribute to what you want to do. And this idea of what he calls perpetual beta. So it's not that you go through a big, when you're creating software, you don't go through a big, long stakeholder consultation process and come up with a big functional spec to create something. Stick it up, if people like it, they use it, if not, you take it down. And over on the left, we've got things like some of the principles, so it's built around democracy, you know, you're as good as your contributions in a way. It's very bottom up, you know, so the idea, like in the blogosphere, anyone can create a blog and start contributing. It's very socially oriented. So at the top, we've got very kind of controlled technology in higher education. I think of your VLE, it's a very centralized system, rights and access is kind of very controlled. We have what we might call us-generated content, you know, these are the books, these are the articles that are worth reading, we think. And it's all about accredited learning as opposed to informal learning. And down at the bottom right, we have this idea of review before release. You know, you think of journal articles, you know, it's kind of, we don't release anything until we've kind of know it's been through a proper review process. And that leads to this idea of kind of filtered intelligence. It's not the case that we let anyone publish anything. We only let we publish things that we think are worthwhile publishing. And we kind of aim for perfection all the time before we release anything. So over on the bottom left, you've got arguably the idea that kind of we know best, we're the academics, that's why you come to us, you know, to teach and stuff. It's a very top-down process, you know, it comes from professors and experts down to students. And it's all based around individual achievement rather than this kind of social achievement. So those are the kind of characteristics that I think embody this kind of clash in a way between these two fields, if you like. We tend to squash or stretch everything into a semester because that's how we're set up to run in universities. And maybe we kind of mess around with course sizes a bit, but basically we're kind of talking about different size apples. And next slide, maybe what we want are different size, different types of fruit, you know, not just different sizes. It's for artistic reasons. But actually, it was driven by the economics of what you needed to do because you're operating in a physical world. You needed to wrap the stuff up, you needed to ship it and sell it and so on. And so as soon as music went digital, we learned that the natural unit of music was the track. Now, I don't think there's a natural unit of learning, but I'm pretty sure that it comes in many different sizes, you know, from 10 minutes to 9 months, whatever you want to do. But at the moment, we're kind of limited by our physical structure. Rock album. But imagine how we formalise learning is a landscape, and it's basically flat, then you have a couple of really sharp peaks when you do undergrad study or postgrad study, and then it's flat again. And next slide. Ecosystems. And the first is like an ecosystem of tools that we're creating at the OU. And they all write to this profile in the center. So it's got an open API that any tool can write to. Okay. Like learner. And this is kind of like Twitter for learning. So think of, during any day, you might have a number of micro-learning events. You know, you might hear something on the radio, or you might see something, or just think of something, and you never really recall those. Is there a kind of culture clash between these two things that's kind of irreconcilable? You know, social networking feels like this often. It's kind of social, you get to meet people, it's fun, you swap ideas, and you do all this kind of stuff. And next slide. Just of these kind of issues, I think, that it raises. And Mino's paradox says, how can I know anything about it? How can I know anything about X if I don't know what X is? Or how can I search for knowledge of X? If I know what it is, then I've already got knowledge of it and can't search for it. And usually this is kind of, this paradox is overcome by a teacher engaging in Socratic dialogue and stuff. The teacher kind of leads you through, provides that structure. But what about in the kind of Web 2.0 internet world, you know, where you kind of just bump into stuff randomly and maybe you find it through a recommendation of somebody, or you see what someone else has written? What happens to that kind of structure? And it's clear that learners value structure and guidance and support. Next slide. Our education is that quality, you know, and this really comes down to that, this idea that David Weinberg talks about in his book, Everything is Miscellaneous, about filtering on the way in and filtering on the way out. Now, in higher education, we've always filtered on the way in. We sort of say, these are the things that are worth publishing. We have a big filter process, and these are the things worth reading. So we have, you know, big libraries and things. And Wikipedia takes the opposite approach. It's kind of user-generated, but you filter on the way out. You know, anyone write anything, but then the good stuff will rise to the top, kind of through various metrics. Openness, which is kind of really interesting for us at the Open University. When we started up, openness meant open access. But now, it's interesting to see that we see the way that term has moved on and evolved. You know, open means open source, open content, open pedagogy, open APIs, all sorts of things. So if you were creating an open university now, you'd be open in many different ways. It needs to be flexible. You know, last year Facebook was the big technology, but this year it'll be something else, so we can't just be tied into a particular technology. It needs to be disruptive in the Christensen sense. He talks about sustaining and disruptive technologies, and sustaining technologies help your existing customers do things better, disruptive technologies reach new audiences. And so social isn't really about, or isn't only about helping existing OU students do things better. It's about finding new learners and new markets. And we want to take on this idea of the perpetual beta. You know, so we'll develop widgets or bring things in, tools in. If people like them, use them, fine. If not, you know, they're going to disappear. It'd be very democratic, so anyone can kind of join in this space, and whatever you want to learn about is fine. You know, it's not, we're not dictating the curriculum or anything. And we hope to bring some of our kind of experience in pedagogy to the table. But I think openness kind of sums up the principles, really.